In recognition of World Elder Abuse Awareness Day, our speakers are Tony Chickadel, staff attorney for California Advocates for Nursing Home Reform, and elder abuse attorney Michael Mullen of Mullen Law. Tony and Michael will address patient rights, how elder care has become corporate care, and how the California law applies. Both Tony and Michael come well credentialed and experienced. They address and protect the rights of some of the most vulnerable among us. I'm going to let you check out their bios, which are extensive, so they can have the rest of the time. Anyway, the bios are on the website. Please welcome Tony Chickadel and Michael Mullen.
Good morning. How are you?
Hey, Tony.
Yeah.
Stay in the middle so that way they don't
have to. Over on the podium.
Podium?
Yep.
I don't like to be constrained. I've been here 30 seconds. I'm already being boxed in.
If you want to choose over there, you got two options. There.
This is fun.
All right.
Okay, so I don't have a lot of time, so I won't do a lot of the stuff, introductory stuff I normally do. I was trying to think of, if you could just know one biographical fact about me that would explain everything, what would it be? And I didn't really come up with anything great, but I thought this might be important. You know, we're really, at least in my case, we kind of are who we are when we're about 7 or 8 years old. I mean, it was like 90% of me. When I was 7 or 8 years old. My two favorite, I don't think they were really classes, activities in school. I didn't like school growing up. I like to sleep in. I like to be lazy. That's still true. But my two favorite activities at school were gym and the library. We used to go to the library once a week and you'd have a half hour to look at books and check books out. You turn the books you checked out last week. And that's kind of everything you need to know about me. I still like gym and library. I like to run around and go to the gym and play ball and stuff and play with my kids. And right back here, there's a bunch of dodgeballs. So maybe clear these tables out and get a game going. And I like library. I like reading books. I like information. You know. And what I really didn't like about school was just this total structure, right? I kind of chafed at that. Library, you were free to explore. I mean, you had to be quiet, which was tough for me, too. But you could explore whatever you liked to check out. You could do that. It was sort of an infinite amount of information at your disposal. And what kind of books did I read? Sports books. I grew up in Ohio. That's where the public school library is where I developed my love for the San Francisco 49ers, oddly enough. There was a book about the 49ers. Joe Montana, I was like, okay, I like this team. And presidents, I like to read about presidents. I think that's kind of like, I went into law, I do a lot of policy stuff. Yeah, maybe there's a connection. Anyway, I'm a staff attorney for California Advocates for Nursing Home Reform. We're a nonprofit based in San Francisco. We also have an office in Los Angeles. And real quick, we do a lot of things. I'll narrow it down to three. We do a lot of stuff related to elder abuse, including financial and physical elder abuse, primarily litigation stuff, lawyer referrals, and policy. We do a lot of stuff related to Medi-Cal, qualifying, particularly for long-term care issues, qualifying, share of cost, and the dreaded estate recovery program, which, hot news flash, the Medi-Cal estate recovery program is about to be extensively reformed in the governor's budget, which should be signed by the end of this month. If you're interested in that, you should check our website. And then the third thing we do, primarily what I do, is deal with consumer problems, consumer questions. People who are in the long-term care system or have a loved one in the long-term care system and they have questions, but usually it's problems. So I hear a lot of bad stuff. Before I get into what I really want to talk about, I want to first of all say thanks. Hearing sort of what you guys do, I'm in a room with really, really good people who do wonderful, much-needed, underappreciated work. I know you probably don't hear thank you enough, so thank you for that. And also, I wanted to say that I'm really happy to be here and talk a little bit about what I do. I got a lot of issues I want to cover, and I only have a little bit of time, so what I thought I'd do is tell you a story about a client of mine where it covers a lot of the issues that I want to go a little bit more in depth about. This woman's name was Rachel, and she lived in Madera County. She had a little home that she owned, and she lived by herself. She had had two kids, a son and a daughter. The son was in the military and lived, I think, in Texas. And he had issues related to wartime service, so he wasn't much of a help in terms of his mother's care. And then she had a daughter who also lived out of state who was more involved, but again, the distance made it a problem for her to really be directly involved too much. The woman, she lived by herself. She did pretty well. She didn't have a lot of money. She did have her little home. She had a reverse mortgage that helped her pay the bills. She got around primarily using a scooter. And so this is what first drew the attention of the county, was she would go on these rural roads with her scooter and her orange flag, and she had read up on the laws, and she kind of knew what her rights were, but the cops would occasionally stop her and say, this is dangerous, you need to not do this. And she said, well, this is how I get around. She had a neighbor who looked in on her from time to time and helped her, take her to doctor's appointments and to the pharmacy and to the grocery store. About once a week, the neighbor would come in and help her out. Well, anyway, Rachel develops an infection. I think it was cellulitis. And she didn't get it treated right away. It kind of progressed, and she didn't really recognize what it was. And like a lot of people with infections, she went in and she got dehydrated. And then she got a little delirious. She ends up calling 911. I think she fell. Calls 911. I can't get up. 911 comes and gets her. And she ends up in the hospital, and the doctor sees an elderly woman who's not making much sense when she talks, and he diagnoses dementia.
Oh, geez.
Which happens a lot. Kim, you talked, the first slide of yours was we care, right, about seniors. And the process I want to talk a little bit about is not a problem because of people don't care. It's a problem because caring isn't enough. And what you see is in each of these stages, if you talk to the care providers or the service providers, they would have told you, yeah, I care about this person. I want good things to happen for her. That's why we're providing care. But in this case, it wasn't enough. And what happens a lot of times in hospitals is we get shortcut diagnoses and shortcut care because of the overwhelming workload. That's sort of a theme throughout the long-term care system. The overwhelming workload leads to some shortcuts and maybe less than stellar care, less than thoughtful care. So Rachel gets diagnosed with dementia. She's not making a lot of sense. She's not necessarily compliant with care. She's trying to get up and go to the bathroom on her own, and she's not supposed to do that because she's having some trouble ambulating. So they give her a sedative, which is an anti-anxiety, which is very common in hospitals, and there's no discussion about risks, benefits, alternatives. It's just, this is what you need, this is what you get. And then they also prescribe her antipsychotic, Seroquel, very popular for dementia in the hospital setting. And what happens was she basically blacks out for about 3 months. She's sort of with it at times, but not really lucid. And she ends up being transferred to a nursing home for rehab. And she spends about two and a half months at this first nursing home. And that nursing home says, well, your therapy days are up under Medicare, so you're going to have to go to another nursing home where they provide, quote, long-term care. One of the issues that I want to talk about a little bit is, it's probably the number one topic in my world right now, which is nursing homes telling lots and lots of people that they only focus on short-term state residents, or that they only have a certain number of beds in the facility for longer-term residents, and those are full. So when you're converting from short-term stay to long-term stay, you've got to leave. You've got to go either to a nursing home that provides this long-term care, or you're going to go to a community-based setting. Absolutely not true. Nursing homes, by definition, are long-term care facilities. They provide long-term care. If a resident is there for short-term rehabilitation and therapy, and that therapy or rehabilitation need is satisfied, but they still need assistance with activities of daily living, they have every right in the world to stay in that nursing home, provided they can pay for it. Right? It's that simple. But so anyway, this for Rachel, very common scenario now, She goes to one nursing home, she exhausts her Medicare rehabilitation coverage, and they send her to another nursing home, which was a place called Alice Manor in Fowler, California. And I've been to a lot of nursing homes, and this was among the scariest I've ever been to. It was locked. There was like a cage, like the pressure chamber that you go to if you're in outer space, where like first you get buzzed in, and then you're in this like little cage, and then someone comes to the door and lets you into the second gate. And then you go in, and honestly, I couldn't tell who was staff and who were the residents. Because the staff were, let's just say, less than professional. So she ends up in this nursing home, and she's getting the psych drugs and the anti-anxiety drugs. All that stayed with her. She finally gets lucid enough to the point where she says, I'm not going to take those anymore. I'm not right. You know, I'm all dizzy, and I'm sleeping all the time. I'm going to refuse my meds. Rachel had a lot of moxie. She had a very unique personality, which got her on the county radar. She had been investigated by ABS at least once, and I think maybe twice, prior to this infection incident. And she got a public guardian involved. Why did she get a public guardian involved? Well, she couldn't, at the time she was hospitalized, make her own decisions, but I think primarily what got the public guardian involved was the fact that she owned a home. And I hate to say that, but if she had not owned a home, I'd
got there, the skilled nursing facility, said, well, you know, I think we can give you rehabilitation to get you back on your feet. It's going to take about 90 days, about the time her Medicare was able to cover her. But stay here for until the end of March, and we think we can take care of her. She did. She didn't like it there very much, so she needed to be medicated with some antidepressants. She was evaluated with a psychologist and determined to have borderline senility, even though 4 or 5 months before that, she was pretty much really with it. She was a pretty, she was, by the way, I forgot. She was about 70 years old. My book, Spring Chicken, but, so she'd gone from a functioning, normal 70-year-old to a deplorable condition in this period of 3 or 4 months, was at the nursing home, getting rehabilitation, and then about 2 weeks afterwards, somebody at the nursing home realized her Medicare was going to run out on January 30th. All of a sudden, she started doing really well according to the records and decided she wanted to go home according to the records. And in fact, the nursing home discharged her the day her Medicare ran out, saying it was time for her to go home. But the nursing home said, we understand you're really not on your feet again, you're going to need some home care. Why not go with this home care agency in San Rafael that we do a lot of business with, they'll take care of you fine. So, the very day she was discharged from the short-term nursing home, when her Medicare ran out, a person came up to pick her up, take her bags, take her home, and it turned out to be the same person who was under investigation by the Marin County District Attorney's Office, the same person that the home care agency had was aware was under investigation by the Marin County District Attorney's Office, and unbeknownst to Mona, she packed her up in her car and took her home. Now, this turned out, Mona thought, to be a great thing, because Mona didn't have any friends. Mona had been divorced, hadn't seen her husband in 10 years. She had one daughter. They didn't get along. She had no one. But this caregiver, Roberta, turned out to be a wonderful person, because Mona couldn't balance her checkbook. Mona could. She couldn't cook for herself. Mona could. She really didn't have the ability to deal with her finances, pay her rent at the time, or anything else, but Mona could. And she had some money because she had worked for the state of California, had a pension, was making $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 a month in her pension payments. So this turned out to be a great thing for both of them. Mona was able to be taken care of Roberta. Roberta took care of her money, and she was probably as happy as she'd ever been. But she didn't do very well. She continued to be depressed. She fell. She got a urinary infection. Another home care agency came in to treat her with her urinary infection, realized she should go to the hospital. They sent her back to the hospital. She stayed there 3 days. And what happens after 3 days in the hospital? Your Medicare is renewed. Suddenly the nursing home said, we'll take you back, no problem. So for another short-term stay, but now that she had Medicare, she went back to the nursing home. The nursing home had Roberta come in, and together, the nursing home and Roberta, who the nursing home understood had her power of attorney, did work, did rehabilitation in the nursing home. Now the two stories join. About the end of her stay at the nursing home, Sarah, district attorney, shows up and says, can I see Mona? Yes, sir. So she goes into her room and says, are these your credit cards? Yeah. Is your checking account? It is. Did you ever fill out this insurance policy on your life? No, never seen it before. Is that your signature? No. So the district attorney realizes that, that she's been financially abused, tells her about it. And there's a thing about financial abuse. People get taken advantage of when they're 30 or 40 or 50. They say, "Hey, my fault." But what happens when you are an elder, when you're a senior, it can be devastating. And it was for this person. She went into a tailspin when she learned what had really happened, which she really never has recovered from, but it took her years to kind of get back on her feet. Nursing home, of course, said, "Sweetheart, your Medicare is running out, and I'm sorry, you're homeless. You don't have any money, but you know, you'll need to switch to another facility." She had no facility to go to, and somebody like you, somebody working in the home care business in San Rafael, learned about this and voluntarily, out of the goodness of their heart, helped her find an assisted living home where she stayed for a year or two, and eventually reunited with her daughter. And now she's living in the foothills, doing about as well as she can be expected to be. What happened to Roberta? The Marin County District Attorney pressed charges. She was tried and convicted of felony elder abuse against my client, against Bowen, and put away in prison for over 2 years. And then deported recently. Out of this country. And the question is, how could that have happened? Really? How could that have happened? Because like Tony says, these people who are working in, except the perpetrator here, the Roberta, bad person. And there's nothing we can do about bad people, because bad people are going, you know, just going to be bad people. You can't do anything about it. But she was in the system. She was in a nursing home twice. They had the ability, they knew what was going on. They knew her lack of capacity. They had an absolute ability to treat her, to keep her there, to be part of the solution. They didn't. The home care agency knew what was going on. The district attorney had visited them, subpoenaed their records before they hooked up the border with their client. They understood she was under investigation. They kept employing her. So I guess what I'm saying is that we have in this country an epidemic, not just of old people, but single old people, people who cannot fend for themselves. About a third of all older people are single. It's growing. The number of old people that are getting past 65 doubles. The number of care providers at home is not increasing. That means they're increasingly going to be taken care of. Single, old people who do not care for themselves, who have no support system, are going to be cared for our institutions, the trust business, the nursing homes, the hospitals, assisted living facilities. And I believe, and I think you believe, because I'm preaching to the choir here, I really think this, but we all have to make sure that the people who are caring for us are held to the standards of care, of trust. And 95% of the time they are. But the degree that we can make our hospitals, our nursing homes, our assisted living facilities really stewards of elder care, fiduciary duty, this is a problem that can be solved, that can be created. Guys like Tony, people like you, you know, together, you know, we can link arms and we really can correct, I think, the system that is now causing elder abuse and abuse. So, that's my speech. I hope you will I want Jenny to say a few words. I know you all know Jenny and she's done such a great job.
Say before we say goodbye. Thank you. Thanks, Mike. And thanks, Tony, and for everyone's attention today. I know we're all ready to run out and get our emails and our equipment and get on with our day. It's busy. Today is June 15th. As you know, it's official World Elder Abuse Awareness Day. So I just wanted to see if we could just take just a second, just a couple moments to have some silence and some reflection for all the victims of elder abuse. Thank you. Today, let's just remember those victims, and I know that we all can make a difference. Thanks, everyone. Have a good day.
Thank you. What did I take away from that? It's all our responsibility to keep our eyes open. You know, all those hotlines, they're anonymous. You can make a phone call. They'll look into it. It's better to make an anonymous phone call, maybe, instead of letting someone fall through the cracks.